All right, Emily, we're here for our interview today. I'm like super excited to have you here. This is Emily Adams, everybody. We sort of connected, I believe it was through Instagram, right? Yeah. We connected on Instagram and you reached out to me. Your story is so remarkable and I'm super excited to have you come in and share your story on what led you here today. And so your background is you were born and raised in the Amish culture, which I am going to get schooled today because I have absolutely no idea. So I'm excited to really learn what life was like for you in that culture, because I really don't have any idea. And I sort of didn't want to look into it because I wanted to get your perspective on that. Like, firsthand perspective is the best, right? And you're also a coach. We're both fellow coaches and you help women or men in the mindset
coaching? Women specifically.
Okay, so we both help out women. So, and you decided to leave the Amish culture at 17. So that's pretty powerful and very young. So I want you to just kind of dive in and just tell us, first of all, give us a little backstory about the Amish culture and what life was like in that.
Yeah, so I will say disclaimer for anyone that watched the reality TV shows, those are not all true.
Okay, I'm glad you said that. Give us the truth, yeah.
So being born and raised in the Amish culture, you know, so we speak fluent German, and we didn't really learn how to speak fluent English until we went to school, which was at the age of 6, and they only go to 8th grade education, which is equivalent to a 6th grade public education. Oh. So then after 8th grade, you know, you're done with school, and the culture of the Amish is very male dominant. The guy is the leaders, they're the leaders of the church. The women are just kind of like the supporters, don't have a voice, you don't say how you feel. The rules around females of what they can and cannot do is very, very strict. Mm-hmm. For example, women aren't allowed to wear any color socks but black, but guys can wear any color socks. So that's just like an example. You know, women always have to keep their hair up. They can't cut their hair. It's always like modest. You always wear a dress. You follow all these rules they have in place. And growing up that way, I was always the child that would question why at all times of like, why do we have to do this? And the Amish is not a religion. It is a culture. Mm. And the kind of the religion that they would follow, they identify as Christians, but it's, you know, they believe in heaven, hell, and, you know, your sins have to be forgiven and all that stuff. And that's a whole other conversation, but it was always presented in church of, God is this amazing God of love. But for me as a child growing up, I always wondered, I was scared of God. I was like, you don't mess with him. Like, I'm super scared. Like, no, we're not gonna be best friends. Like, that's not how it works. And so growing up in that culture of having that fear, and you never ever get divorced in the Amish culture. Mm-hmm. That does not happen. You are married. If you get pregnant with a guy, you're automatically married to him. You don't have a choice. And so it's very, you don't ever get divorced. It's very hide everything, numb it out. Mm. And you don't speak about your feelings. You don't speak about what's going on. Even down to where I didn't even know what a period was. No one had that conversation with me. And I thought I was dying. You know, here I am, like, I forget what, 12 or 13. And I'm like, I'm dying. Like, I'm literally going to die because I had no idea. So there's zero like education for females. So after you go through school, eighth grade, I graduated eighth grade when I was 13, and kind of the career path for a female is you get out of school, then you learn like cooking, cleaning, you know, basic household sewing, because they do all their own sewing. And you really just do a lot of the household work while the guys are out working. So that was kind of the career path. And then at 16, you start dating, and usually by 18, you're married and you start having kids, and it's nothing for you to have like 3 or 4 kids by the time you're 22. Like,
do you get to decide who to marry, or is it decided for you?
No, you do get to pick, but I say that, but your parents have a very strong opinion about it. So you do have that choice. And for me, when I got out of school, I hated doing anything indoors. I hated it. So I didn't take no interest in anything inside. And anytime I could be outside with my dad doing like tomboy stuff, I was there. So then that kind of led me to really hang out with my dad a lot. And I started to question a lot of things, like, how come the guys can wear pants, but I can't wear pants even to ride horses? Like, let's talk about this. And it was always like, no, we don't talk about that. We don't question the rules that are put in place. They're put in place to hold you to a modest standard. And if you break these rules, if you're a member of the church, you have to confess in front of the church. And if you continue to break them, you're not being obedient to God because you've broken these rules. So it's very brainwash type of stuff of like, if you don't follow these rules, you're going to hell. Like, and they will tell you.
I'm completely oblivious. So you're saying it's Christian based, right? So it does it go... Are you in the Bible? Are you in the, is it like a different version of the Bible, let's just say, or would it, what word are you listening to?
So, yeah.
Again, I have no idea.
They use the King James Version Bible.
Okay.
So that's the Bible they use, but it's kind of like picked certain Bible verses and made to what they want it.
Okay.
So it's kind of like, we'll take this Bible verse and interpret it the way we want it. Yes, we believe God came and he died for our sins, but there are some sins that are not forgivable.
Okay.
So clearly, you know, that's like a conflict, right? If you read the whole Bible. So that's kind of the Bible that they use. And so always growing up, it's always been, if you leave the culture, you're showing disobedience and you don't have a shot of going to heaven. That's always been their way of kind of keeping like everybody toned in. Right. So then after at about seven, so at 16, I lost one of my best friends in a buggy accident, and her and her boyfriend got killed on the highway. A semi had sideswiped their buggy. And that really kind of spiraled me to thinking, there's got to be more to life. Strictly because at her funeral, mind you, her funeral was big. There was like 1,000 people at her funeral. And they had said, we can't be sure that they're ever going to get to heaven. And I'm thinking there, one, you know, it's a close friend, so it hits home even more. And I'm thinking, if we say we're not supposed to judge, we just judged right there. And you are saying words that are not even from a place of love. If God is this God of love, like, whoa, people, like, what is going on? And that kind of really led me to kind of push back on everything. So I refused actually to become a member. I was like, no, I'm not going to. Usually at 16, you're kind of required to go through the membership thing. And I was like, no, I don't want to. And then, you know, it becomes one of those things like, well, you're going to have to become a member at some point. And so that happened, and then I started getting into trouble. I got caught drinking. So if they're not allowed to drink alcohol or smoke or do any of that stuff. And I was hanging out with some friends, and we got caught drinking, and I got grounded for like 6 months.
Wow.
So, you know, that just kind of poured a little bit of salt on the wound of like, I really hate it now. And I was like the angry person, but at the same time, I always felt so trapped because I had zero voice. I had zero say in anything. They dictated my whole future. And I was really, really smart in school and loved school. I loved to learn. And I've always thought, what would it be like if I could have a college degree? Like, what would that be like? And I love to play in sports and be athletic and all these things. And I couldn't do any of that. Like, they don't have sports.
Allowed to do any sort of physical, like, sports activities?
they're allowed to do physical sports, but not in a competition level the way we would in like today's society. So they don't compete in any of their sports, if that makes sense. Mm-hmm. And so we just never had that opportunity. We never worked out at all, zero, like working out. And it was just kind of like, you work to work out. Like if you worked, you had a physical job, you were, that's your workout.
Right, right. So basically women are raised or groomed to be domestic, right? So yeah. Your job, so are they, and where is this? What state was this in, or were you at?
Oh, so they're actually in every state. Okay. It's just kind of different locations. So for me, I was born and raised in Indiana, and it was kind of in the central state. Okay. And I will say for those that there are multiple different types of Amish as well. And there's the type that do not have any running water at all, or no electricity, no nothing. And then there's the type that have the running water and they can have like the gas refrigerator, gas stove, but you still don't have electricity. That's how I was raised. So I was still raised with a bathroom and running water and, you know, the gas appliances. And then there's the other type of Amish that are a little bit more liberal, and they allow a little bit more things.
Okay. Okay. So, and are you allowed to go to college? So you're not allowed to even leave the home ever?
No one is ever allowed to go to college. So even the guys, like they don't, once you come out of school as a guy, you're automatically going to go help your dad work on a construction crew, or you're going to like help your dad build his business that he has. So they, none of them have college educations.
Wow. How many other siblings did you have?
So I have two sisters and three brothers.
And were you sort of the rebel child that they all come falling in line, and you were the one who was sort of rocking the boat?
Yes, definitely rocking the boat on every angle. Believe it or not, growing up though, I was the most behaved child. I was very chill, laid back. I did not like, there's a lot of drama, judgment, a lot of like judging this person because their dress was too short or this person's hair was out of line. And it's just a lot of drama within the community. And I always like tried to stay away from that and the gossip, because it was exhausting for me. And so I am the middle, kind of in the middle. So there's two younger, and then there's three older than me. So it's kind of in the middle child. And I was the first one out of my family to actually leave. And when I left, and when my family knew that I was kind of like leaning towards that way, then they stepped in and started with like the brainwashing of, if you leave, you cannot come back. You cannot come see us. You are going to go to hell. Your children will go to hell. Like all these crazy things, right? And then the church steps in and will try to come and have conversations with you. And that was actually the first time I got really good at being able to look at someone and block you out completely and not even listen to you.
Wow.
Like I could just
survival mechanism.
Yeah, it was the survival. And I learned years later, I had to unlearn that mechanism, because right. I was blocking out things that I shouldn't be blocking
out. Right. Well, you had to at the time because it protected
right.
you. Right? So at what point did the church step in after? Well, I want you to bring us to when you were 17. And then did you have contact? Did the church try? They knew before then that you were trying to leave before 17, or was this after?
So at 17, my parents found it out. Okay. And then the church also found it out. So after my parents got done talking with me, then the church stepped in. And there was a variety of people that would come and see me on a day-to-day basis. I would get letters. I would get like all kinds of communication to try to keep me there, to try to convince me. A lot of fear tactics.
Sure. So bring us to what was going on at 17? Like what happened?
So at 17, and then my parents lived 2 hours away from my oldest sister. She was actually married and had kids. And my parents didn't want me to stay with them and my two brothers, because they were scared I was going to convince my two brothers to go with me. Mm. So they asked me to go stay with my sister and her husband, because there was no way I was going to convince them, because they were already married and had their life.
Right.
So I went to go stay with them, And I realized with being with them, it wasn't going to change anything. I was still miserable. I was still felt so trapped, and like I could not even breathe. It was like, it was just a trapped feeling. Like I had no purpose. Mm-hmm. And I had actually had been talking to a guy that was not Amish, and I, clear transparency, because if you watch my YouTube, my story's out there, but he was 38 and I was 17. Mm-hmm. And I was not educated enough to realize, yo, red flag. Right. So I, at my sister's, I left in the middle of the night, contacted him, and that's how I got out.
Wow.
And that was also the start of being, that was the toxic narcissist marriage that I was in. And that's kind of what led it to me leaving at 17 in the middle of the night, literally jumped out of a two-story bedroom of, you know, I was like, I have to jump. And I jumped and I was like, I'll figure it out later, left with a trash bag of clothes, and that was it. Mm-hmm. And left with him, and being from that culture, I didn't see this age gap. There's some serious red flags and you need to look at it. I wasn't even educated on what dating looked like.
So he was not in the Amish community.
No.
Yeah.
He was not.
Okay.
And so so my goal was to actually get out, to get an education and like make a life for myself, right? I wanted to go to college, I wanted to do all these things. I got out, I went to go get tested for my GED to get my high school education. And I tested at a sixth grade education. So I started taking GED classes. Meanwhile, got pregnant at 18 with my oldest. And in the Amish culture, it's going back to, as soon as you get pregnant, you better get married. Like that's just, that's standard.
So at your, before backing up just a little bit, you guys end up getting married. You weren't married yet with him. You were,
no.
You moved out and started living with him.
I was living with his sister, and then I ended up moving in with him.
So there was no more communication then with your parents. There, you were shut out. So
right.
The minute you jumped out of the house, that was yes. It. There was no more communication with your family?
Right, right.
Okay, wow, okay.
So there was like, so when I look back now, there was this thing of, I was going through the whole culture shock of like, holy cow, like I don't even know what's going around me, to having this big dream of let's get the education and like see how well I can do for myself, to then throw in the dating thing with him. And he knew how the Amish culture worked, so he knew what games to play with me to get me to make those commitments, right?
To manipulate the situation.
Yeah. So I ended up getting pregnant and I was like, I freaked out. I was like, hold, like I had, there was no intention of me. Like, I was like, I can't, I don't even know how to be, like, I'm not ready to be a mom. Like, I don't even know. And I freaked out and I was like, we have to get married. Like, you know how my parents feel. And he was like, okay, cool.
So well, of course, right? Have control over you, even though yes. You're not even in contact with them whatsoever.
Yeah. So I ended up having Jordan, and then we ended up getting married, and I got married at 19. And within a year and a half, I realized what happens, because I was now more in outside of the culture, educating myself on all these things. I was trying to figure out, man, what is going on in the Amish culture? Why is there a thing like this? To holy cow, now I'm in this marriage, like, and I don't need to be there. Like, it was not a healthy marriage.
Right.
And I felt so much guilt around filing for a divorce, because I knew at that point, like, I'm just going to hell. Like, I'm out here, I don't have anyone that I really know, and I'm just going to go to hell. So I might as well just burn my bridges while I'm at it. Like, might as well just live my best life.
might as well be unhappy. Yeah.
Yeah. So then I was like, I was going to file for divorce, and I found out I was pregnant with my second son. And then it was like, okay, now I have two kids. I have no idea what single mom even means. I don't even know what it looks like. And I, out of fear, again, I decided to stay. He had no idea I was thinking about a divorce. Mm. And out of fear, I stayed. And I kept trying to get him to go to counseling, you know, for the drinking, trying to get us to go to marriage counseling to make it work, because we were like two different people. The verbal abuse at the time, I didn't realize just how much it was affecting me, because I wasn't used to having any women empowerment even in my life.
Right.
And I was used to just the women just do it all. So I was cooking, cleaning, working 60, 70 hours a week, and he was doing nothing. So part of that picture, I was like, okay, wait, you're supposed to be the guy. You're supposed to at least have a job. But he played it back onto me like, no, you need to make the money. So I was doing all these things, and this is how bad it was. And I didn't realize, after having my oldest son, I went back to work 3 weeks after he was born because of the fact that he had told me, if you don't go back, we're not going to be able to pay our bills. I had no idea what we had coming in, what bills we were paying, and he was gambling a ton.
Wow.
So all this was going on. So out of guilt, I was like, okay, like, I guess I'll go back. And when I say go back to work, it wasn't a desk job. It was working on the factory. I was like an associate on the floor. So it wasn't like I was doing my body any favors. So I went back to work, and it was like living hell for a long time because I didn't get to see my son, and I was working so many hours, even volunteering, just to make ends meet.
And at this time, you have two children. You already have.
Yes, now I have two children.
Watching the children while you're out at work?
Yeah, so that was the other thing. Like, I didn't know if he was going to be drinking while watching my boys. So there was a lot of fear, like, and I was working second shift, barely sleeping 4 hours just to be able to keep it all together. And the breaking point for me was he came home drunk, and it was in the middle of the day, and he had taken all of the boys' toys. The boys were playing on the floor, and he had taken all the boys' toys and just threw them out the door. And the look on both of my boys' face was just, there was fear. Like, they had no idea what was going on, and it hit me. I not only needed to get out of this for myself, but for my boys, because I didn't know how safe we were going to be. Like, what's going to happen next if this happens? And that was the point of, okay, we've got to come up with a plan, and I need to figure out how to get out. And it took me 3 times to leave the marriage. I filed for divorce twice. I filed once, canceled it because he talked me out of it. He used the whole guilt trip of, you know, you can't get divorced because you know what the Bible says. You know what your parents say. He used every single bit of that against me.
Right.
And so I was like, okay, fine. Like, I give up. We won't get divorced. He agreed to go to counseling. That lasted one session. That was it. And then he started drinking again. And finally I was like, got to the point of, I'm done. I don't care. Burn in hell or not. Like, I'm getting out. And the last time I went to go leave with the boys, he was actually there. I had to call the cops to be able to leave because he was going to slash my tires.
Wow.
So.
Yeah, that's amazing. You're so brave. I just, as moms, like, you know, and I say this to so many women, like, and myself included, we won't do things sometimes for ourselves, right? But when we see how us staying affects our children, and then you sort of have a little visual about what that would look like, right? How do you have just stayed and realize how it would affect them, then it moves us, right? Then we're willing to walk through fire to get out so that they won't have to do it, right? So, I mean, that's just so courageous of you to just,
I also want to say, because I hear this a lot, well, I don't know how. Mm-hmm. Well, guess what? I had $600 to my name. Mm-hmm. I didn't know how, but I knew by staying there, I was never going to figure it out. So when it comes to how do you walk away from that, you walk away with the faith that you're going to be provided for, because that's all I had. Right. I mean, I had literally $600. I'm like, I will figure it out.
So where did you go from there?
So I stayed with my friends for, I think, a week until I could get an apartment. And I was able to get an apartment because I borrowed a down payment of $700, And then I was able to get an apartment on my own because I could show I had income. And that's kind of where I started, but it didn't end there because then I started dealing with the harassing texts, the threatening to kill me, and I would turn it into the cops with the voicemail, and the cops told me, I'm sorry, I can't do anything for you because you guys have children together.
Wow. Wow. So it's okay that he was harassing you and threatening you.
Yeah. Even though he would show a
restraining order or anything like that.
So the restraining order just got thrown out. but part of that is he knew everybody in the county. So he knew the judges, he knew the cops, and it was a very dirty situation. But I had told the last time he had come to my apartment and wouldn't leave me alone, I looked at the cop and I said, you can either tell him to leave or I'm going to get my handgun. And if he comes through that door, I will use it. Kind of smirked at me. And I was like, don't. I went out and got my handgun, got my handgun permit. And I was like, I will use it. Because wow. It got to the point where I couldn't even sleep at night because I didn't know what was going to happen.
Yeah, that's just mind blowing. So how did you get through that? Like, where did you, where did you go from there? Did you leave away from him? Did you stay in the same city? Like, how did that work out?
So I stayed in the same city, because I worked there, my whole life was there. We fought, it was a nasty custody battle, but I had talked to my attorney. And this is another thing is, if you talk to an attorney and don't feel like they'll say, yeah, the retainer's $2,000, whatever, it is to get through all of this. If you tell them, look, I'll make payments, most of them will work with you. And that's what I had to do. I couldn't pay up front to have someone go fight this. And I was like, look, this is what's going on. And he was from the county and he said, it's going to cost you $500, but it might be worth you moving your case out of the county to a different county. He's like, you take your chances of what county you get. So I made the choice to move it out of county. And when I moved that case out of county, we went to court twice. The second time, that judge was very clear to him about harassing because I showed him all the text messages, all the threats. Like, I would get texts like you wouldn't believe of how I was going to hell. I was a manipulator. I was like everything under the sun every single day. It wouldn't matter.
How did you cut off that communication? At what point did you say, okay, I'm not going to allow this anymore?
So we could not cut off communication via text or phone because we had kids together and he still would be able to have access. But the judge had suggested if he did not keep it clean and just communicate about kids, he would have to pay for the text service where they monitor what you are texting.
Right. Yeah. Cause they have a lot of apps now or services where you can do that for anyone that's listening that is in the same situation. Mm-hmm. How are you able to move it out to a different county? Did you originally file in your county?
Yes. So I filed in my county and then I told my attorney that my attorney was actually the one that suggested if we move it out of county just to try to get a better ruling because what was happening, he got a DUI and they still gave him joint custody. And I was still fighting for full custody. And I was fighting for him. So he was getting more visitation rights. He was getting more than just the once a week and every other weekend at the time. And then he got the DUI and we still went back to try to show, he's drinking with my kids. My boys would come home and say, Dad was drinking while he was driving. And there's nothing that I could do. He would have the beer can open. My boys are old enough to know what the alcohol was. And the verbal abuse was now coming into the kids. And there was, I started putting them through therapy, trying to build a case of hey, look, this is what's going on. And it got to the point where the last time my oldest son, because it hit my oldest a little bit more earlier than my youngest, he would cry every time he had to go. Like, he would literally just melt down and cry. And we went to in front of the judge, and the judge finally looked at us and said, you know what? I hear both sides and I see a lot of this. So I want to talk to both of your boys without either one of you in the room.
And how old were they at the time?
So they were 10 and 8 at the time.
Okay, so what happened when he talked to the kids?
So once he talked to the boys, I don't know what was said, right. You know, because we weren't there, but he talked to the boys. He came out and he ruled that I would get joint custody, but with the full custody thing where he only gets them every other weekend and one, like 4 hours on a Wednesday night.
Okay.
And then it kind of led to that happened. And, you know, meanwhile, he would still show up at games, tell them how worthless they were in front of these teams. Like, it was unreal of what he was still doing, but there was nothing I could do because I didn't have enough evidence to go to court. And then one day, my oldest, he was 11. Yeah. Cause it's been 3 years. So he was 11 and he had made a remark about me, you know, as a person, and his dad did. And his dad was like, you know, she's no good for nothing. And it was like putting me down. And my oldest was like, no, that's actually not true. Mm-hmm. And that stemmed a huge argument. And he told him, if you feel that way about your mom and you don't see how worthless she is, do not come back. Wow. And it broke his heart, but he came back. He came home and he goes, yeah, it sucks. And like it was rejection, but at the same time he was relieved he didn't have to go back and go through that. And so then 6 months later, the same thing happened with my youngest. And so after that, he just walked away and he walked away and he was like, you know, I'm done. I don't like whatever. That's
important what you said. I want to stay with that for a minute because, you know, obviously there's lots of parents where they worry about the other parents sort of manipulating, right, and alienating and turning the children against them. Because your kids could have easily said, you know, dad's right, right? Mm-hmm. Mom is this. So what do you think you did differently where your son was able to see mom's truth, where that didn't work? What do you think, you know, how do you think that your son was able to see that?
Yeah. So I will tell you, that was one of my biggest fears. That was one of my biggest fears of my boys are going to turn against me, mm-hmm. because he's constantly putting this in their brain. Mm-hmm. And they would come home and ask me what certain words meant because their dad had called me that. And I think what I did differently was I refused from the get-go to badmouth their dad. Mm. And I would always tell them, they would come home and they would be upset, you know, why did dad say this about you? And I would always tell them, you know how your mom is. I am not going to convince you that your mom is bad or it's good. You get to decide if what your mom is to you. Mm. No one gets to decide that. Yeah. You get to decide what your dad is. Do I approve of what he does? Absolutely not. You know, I don't approve of the drinking and all that stuff and the verbal abuse. Now, when they came home and said, you know, my dad said I'm worthless, I would correct that. I would say, you know, that's not true because let's think about this. If you're worthless, what about all these things? So that's not necessarily true. And I would try to correct it right there at the spot, but I would never go back and badmouth their dad. And it took so much strength to not badmouth him because there was times like I was seething with anger of like, okay, time out. Like, I just need a moment because I'm about to tell them exactly what their dad is. But it's your children are going to decide and they're going to know. Children are really good at knowing who is coming from love, mm-hmm. and who is coming from the anger and the hate. They don't want to be around that parent that is constantly bad-mouthing the other parents. Because it's not what they want. And that was so hard for me to let go as a mom of like, they would come home, you know, they say, you know, the fun things they did with their dad. And I would just be seething internally of like, oh, he's still such a piece of shit because like he's sitting here manipulating your brains, but
well, imagine for a second if you did do that, right? And yeah. how you would have changed the dynamic. Mm-hmm. Now maybe the kids are thinking, oh, well, maybe mom is that because she is bad mouthing my father, who's still a part of who they are, right? Mm-hmm. And now you just change the dynamic. Instead of you standing in your truth, right, and not lowering yourself to this hateful, negative energy, and by you standing in that light, and not by even the words out of your mouth, but by your being who mm-hmm. you were, right, this energy that you were standing in. And yeah, it's hard as hell. It's hard as hell when you feel like somebody's literally threatening your life and your mm-hmm. children. And then you're having to constantly remind yourself, and that's a lot of mental energy that you had to be in, constantly minding your thoughts and minding your language, mm-hmm. right? But we have to be in that place of minding what we're saying to them, because, and not only what we're saying to them, but our energy and our being, right? Yes. So if you need a minute to walk out and be like, okay, I can't have this conversation right now, let me collect my thoughts. Mm-hmm. What do I really want to teach my children? Because if you could have easily been like, you know what? Yeah, your dad's a piece of S. You know, he's an alcoholic, drunk, and worthless, good for nothing. Mm-hmm. What would that have done to them? Like, because you stood in a place of not giving your power away, because that's really what it was, a power struggle, right?
Yeah.
He was trying to still control you. Meanwhile, you're divorced and living in two separate homes.
Yeah, absolutely.
Children to control mom, and you were still a pillar, and you stood in that truth, and that I just honor you for that, because I know how brave that is and how hard it is, really hard. So just bless you. That's just beautiful.
Yeah, it's not something that just clicked overnight. I mean, we're talking, this is, you know, a decade, even more than a decade of, you know, and even to this day, they know the truth, right? And we've talked a lot and done a lot of therapy, but I'm still not going to say horrible things about their dad. I'm going to, you know, the truth is, yes, he's an alcoholic. And yes, he did verbal abuse you, because that's why you feel like you can't get an A- on your test, because it's not good enough. Mm. Like, you're crying because you didn't get an A+ and you got an A-. You know, you're crying because you have 400 yards in football and you should have got 450. Mm. Like, so all of this programming comes back to the way you've been talked to. And so they're very much aware of that programming as we've gone through, you know, therapy, and there's, you know, different things that I now implemented as a mom to try to help reprogram that.
And yeah, this is why I tell women that you could be divorced but still energetically married, right? Still attached. And you were with your family, right? You were still energetic. You left home, which you didn't really leave home, just physically you left home. Mm-hmm. But that home and those beliefs and ideologies still followed you.
Yep.
It doesn't matter where you are in the world, that still was owning you, right? It controlled you. At what point did you realize, okay, I need to start putting the oxygen mask on myself, where you started changing those beliefs, and not in your marriage, but the beliefs that you carried as even a child? It's like, at what point did you realize, okay, that's not,
so
life's work.
Man, there was some time, after we had first gotten divorced, I actually had started working out in the gym, because I had gained like 55 pounds with my youngest. And there is kind of where I will say some of the civilization happened for me. And then I also enrolled in school. I was bound and determined to get my bachelor's degree. So I became a college student, and that was a very eye-opening experience for me, because I learned a lot of different cultures. I started making new friends. I started understanding, this is actually what women empowerment is. This is actually what this means. And I'm like, okay. And then it kind of shifted, a lot kind of shifted, but none of it really made me realize how much I was still hanging on to the Amish culture until COVID hit this last year. And it was, I had done a meditation challenge, and through that, I realized, wow, like, I'm still very much religious programmed, like a culture programming of, you know, how I was raised. And I never felt like I had the power to go back and say, you know, that's no longer who I am. And that's not really any part of me, and to let it go. And then there was this moment of, well, then who am I? Like, if I'm not part of this, like, where do I fit in? So it was like, I had to do some identity work, and that's really where the reprogramming started. And I will be honest, that is really where I was able to forgive him for what he put me through. And it wasn't just an overnight thing, but it was a process. But I was able to process it and come from love now and see him as the hurt boy that he was growing up and why he did the things he did. And that's really like through that process and really understanding spirituality more, and nothing against like religion or religion cultures. Spirituality really like opened up in a whole other door for me. And then understanding what really is love, because I feel like for my entire life, I was chasing that feeling. I wanted that feeling. I looked into it for in things, you know, that's what drove me to get my bachelor's degree in 4 years as a single mom working full time. I thought if I had that piece of paper, I would feel enough. I would feel loved. That's what drove me so hard. And it also drove me into a second marriage of thinking if I get into this other marriage, I'm going to feel loved. But I didn't find that feeling until I really found out who I am as a person and realizing, wow, I can love myself and I can give that to myself. And I always thought, like, when people said, well, you know, fall in love with yourself, I'm like, y'all are crazy. Like, nobody does that. I always thought that. Like, I always thought, like, these people are crazy. They don't have a life. Like, they don't understand. And now I'm like, right? Those people.
What are you smoking? Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, you don't really know until you do, and then you're just like, wow, right? Like, you really, really not looking for outside source, because that those outside sources, as you can see, are never going to fill this void inside, because they just can't, right? They don't, right. They don't know how. Like, we could only give this to ourselves. So that true healing, and through forgiveness and through surrender and through letting go of the limiting beliefs and, mm-hmm. you know, through all that work sort of led you to, okay, it's really not about them. And it's beautiful that you were able to see your ex as a wounded child, right? Because like people in pain want to hurt other people. Like they want you to feel their pain. And that's really, it's not intentional. Like he never did the work himself. And so when you get to that place where you see them, and I think many, many divorced moms who have healed, truly healed, will be able to see their ex-partner as that little wounded person, right? Because we're not our behavior. He's not the drunk alcoholic.
Right.
He's a child who is used that as a coping mechanism in order to survive and get through, and he never healed that part. So it's beautiful that you've been able to do that. And that's a gift that you give your children. So no matter how he shows up, your children have a mom that sees her loving herself and fully, and being that mentor that you didn't have that mentor, right? But you are that mentor.
Yeah.
You are that mentor. And so that's beautiful. How long after, so you got remarried, and how
long? So I actually, so I went through college. We ended up being together we dated for 5 years, and then we were married for 2 years, and he had come home and said, I don't love you anymore. We had been having some marriage problems, and we tried counseling and tried different things, and he just came home one day and is like, you know, I'm done. And he's like, I fell out of love with you. And I was like, what? Like, does this happen? Like, is this real life? Like, wow. And in that moment, not only I felt so much guilt because round one clearly didn't work out. Now we're going to round two. And it was like, man, and I fought it. I fought it so hard. I tried to, you know, do everything to still make it work. But after I let it go and I was like, okay, I'm done. I've done everything I can. There was a moment of like, I had to make this choice of I can either pull it together and really figure out who I am, or I can just start numbing it out. And I'll be honest, like I numbed it out. I numbed it out by binge eating. I numbed it out by powerlifting. I would work out.
Right?
Yeah. I would work out so freaking hard. Like people are like, how do you do it? And I'm like, oh, like it's my therapy. But I realized I had gotten to the point and I had landed, you know, my dream job in the corporate world. And on the outside, I had everything together. Mm-hmm. I had painted, you know, beautiful picture. I had it all together. But on the inside, I had gotten so burned out. And, you know, I was now still, again, a single parent. And I was like, I don't know. Like, it was just going back to just me and the boys. And I didn't allow myself any time to process or heal or do any of that. And I just didn't know where or even what to begin. And I gotten burned out. And my friend told me, she goes, you have two choices. Go check yourself in and get help, or go take a momcation. And I was like, what? I was like, neither one of those choices sound good, because I don't take momcations. I've never taken a vacation by myself. And she was like, I'm being serious.
Yeah.
So I had went to see, and I came home, opened my laptop, and I Googled, like, where do I want to go? And I Googled California. Literally Googled it. San Diego pops up, and I'm like, oh, that looks really cool. And so I booked it. Bought the ticket and everything, because I knew if I didn't buy it, I was going to back out and not go. And then I was like, what do I want to do while I'm in San Diego? And I was like, I've always wanted to go skydiving. So I booked and paid for the skydiving, because once I pay, like, I'm showing up.
Ego can't sabotage you anymore.
Yeah. So I did that all literally, and I left the next week. So I took that vacation. And on that vacation, I was like, the first day I did nothing but cry on the beach. Like it was like releasing. Mm-hmm. And I just cried, and I was still stuck with a house and everything. I literally told myself, you know what? I'm going to like figure out who I am and what I want. Like I'm not dating. I'm going to figure out who I am and what I want. And you know, the not dating part was so hard for me, because like I wanted that external validation. Like I needed that, you know, like I really wanted it, but I was like, can't do it. You know, we're going to heal, figure this out. And I came home, sold my house in one day, and ended up moving an hour away from where we were living. And this was a huge like move. I didn't know anyone an hour away. And everybody's like, you all right? And I'm like, yep, I'm good. So we moved. It was an incredible move for me and the boys. Meanwhile, things at work, I knew I wasn't meant to stay there. And, you know, I was in a leadership role. It was a higher up level role. And I got so tired of not being able to make an impact. And two, it was an automotive, which is about 25% female. So I had to really stand my ground. And like, it was like, I was in divine, the masculine energy all the time.
Yeah.
And it even affected
burnout, right?
Yeah. It even affected how I was with my boys. Like I couldn't bring in that feminine energy, that loving person that, you know, they needed as a mom.
Wow.
And I made the decision to leave in February, and I took a leap of faith, left corporates in February, and then COVID hit. And I left corporate to actually do nutrition and online coaching, because I compete in powerlifting. I'm certified in macronutrition, but that wasn't in alignment with me. Like it just didn't work. So COVID hit, and I really took a few steps back of like, I had a mentor that I had hired for my business, and he had told me, instead of doing, just be. And at the moment I was like, that is the stupidest thing anyone ever said to me.
What he's trying to say is to be in your feminine, right?
So that happened, and I kind of went on this. Then I did the meditation challenge, because, you know, COVID, I was scrolling Facebook, like killing time. And it's interesting, because a year before that, my friend had told me, you should meditate. And I was like, no, powerlifters don't meditate. We don't do that stuff. That's too woo-woo like for me. Like, I would be like, only moms stay in a circle.
Masculine, yeah.
Yeah.
You're not letting
me. I did the meditation challenge, and I remember the day it hit me. And mind you, I could not meditate for more than 5 minutes. Mm-hmm. Like that's was my capacity. Some days it was 2 minutes.
Yeah.
But Deepak Chopra had said something really powerful in one of his videos. It's not about the time you spend, but it's about making it a daily practice. And I was like, man, I'm committed to this 21 days. Like, it's just 21 days. Yeah. And the day it hit me, I walked outside, and for the first time in my life, I saw beauty in flowers. Oh, I saw beauty in like the trees and the birds. And I came back in and I was watching my boys, and I started to tear up of just watching, like being present.
Yeah.
And I realized I was never really present, like really listening to them. Like, and I was just in awe of like, man, like I missed out like all of this time of not being present. And that really led me to even more self-discovery and really figuring out, okay, if I can do this in meditation, like what happens when I start doing all these things? And then I was like, started on the Joe Dispenza thing of like how our brains are conditioned. I'm like, yo, this is some stuff. Like, yeah. I got some time here.
Like, where else can I learn? Like, you're so open, right? And I think that's something really important. And I want to shed light to this because it's sort of a pattern that I see in a lot of women. And when you were saying you were feeling burned out, right? You were in burnout. And that's sort of a gateway or invitation to many women that are listening to this right now that are just like, oh, I'm just so tired. Like, I'm just working all the time. Or I'm a single mom and I'm their mom and dad, right? You had to be dad. Dad wasn't around. So you had to be that go-getter, right? You had to go work. But like what your coach was trying to tell you, well, first of all, we're going to burn out being in that energy, right? Because we can't keep going. It will physically manifest in our bodies as well. Is being able to get to a place where we're, even if you're a single mom, like you still need that time to just slow down and rest and allow and receive, because we cut off that intuition, right? You went outside, you started communicating with nature, with the great big world out there, maybe disconnected to whatever other chaos is going on during COVID, which is obviously lots of us are doing, right? We're being forced to sort of get outside and connect with nature because we're not connecting as much with each other anymore. And it's forcing us to realize that we're still all connected. But I think it's important that you got into that feminine energy and finding that balance, right?
Yes.
And that, so if you are someone that's feeling burnout, that's sort of a little red flag of, hey, something, and I'm glad you didn't date. Because have you dated before masculine energy, you probably would have attracted another wounded relationship.
Yeah.
And you, right, you know that you would have attracted that. But yeah, I mean, wow, your story is truly, truly remarkable. And one last question that I want to ask you, are you still fully out of communication with your family, or is that's doors shut for you?
So it was shut for a long time. But so when I left later, my two sisters had left and they had children. So those were grandchildren. So then that kind of started the communication of, well, we want to see our grandchildren. So then it was more of, well, you can come back on holidays. And then it kind of started opening back up. So now we have a relationship. It's kind of like agree to disagree on some things. You know, it's certain topics we just don't discuss. There's still certain rules that we have to respect when we go to visit them. Just out of respect, I do it. There for a while, it was like, well, you have to wear a dress when you come home. And I was like, well, then I'm not coming home. Like, I'm not going to come visit you. So, but now it's more, you know, we're back to having a better relationship. And I do it strictly for my boys, because I feel, you know, and they're still, you know, I'm not going to sit here and lie. There's still healing that has to be done on my part. You know, I've worked through a lot of it, but it's easy to sit here and blame, you know, blame and play the victim game of like, it's their fault they didn't raise me. It's their fault they didn't, you know, teach me that. But it's been a good lesson for me to stand in and take responsibility. So we still communicate occasionally, you know, we see each other on the holidays, but yeah.
Yeah. Wow. That's remarkable. Thank you so much, Emily, for really letting us into your life and sharing this very powerful story. I mean, I just know people are going to connect to this. I mean, I could even hear similarities on my journey with your story. So thank you for your courage, your bravery, your light, for just being a gift in this world. Where can everyone find you and connect with you? And I'm going to put all your stuff, you know, I'll put all your links, but if you want to tell everyone where they can find you.
Yeah. So everything is on my website. It's emilyadams.net. I am huge on Instagram. So I love like posting all my stories. My Instagram is inspire, empower, and impact.
Okay. I'm going to put all that too, if anyone missed that. And if you have any questions for Emily, just reach out to her or check out her website.
Yes, definitely. Right. Send me a message.
Thank you again so much. I do so appreciate you. Thank you so much. Have a good one. Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, bye-bye.